being honorably received and consulted by national presidents, prime ministers, governors, kings and queens in 40 nations worldwide for wise and creative advice, Dr. Indy Audu has released God's Mega Strategies for a Successful Government and a Prosperous Nation. In this international bestseller, Dr. Audu reveals the hidden wisdom and strategic plans that God gave King Solomon to lead the nation of Israel to become the greatest, the richest, and most powerful kingdom on earth. Sure enough, our world leaders today seriously need the problem-solving genius that King Solomon had in order to succeed in every area of life and governmental leadership on national, state, and local levels so as to pull their people out of the global crisis we're now facing. God's Mega Strategies for a Successful Government and a Prosperous Nation is also for aspiring visionary leaders, business owners, churches, and colleges too. So, to obtain your copy of this eye-opening book, log on to www.mymiracletv.org or call right now at 1-229-638-1065.
The Lord! Hallelujah! May the saints of God around the whole world praise His holy name. You are sinners too. You can start off with your praise, but guess what? If you can start off with repentance, that is good. Hallelujah! Because repentance will lead you to salvation. And once you have the Savior inside your life, praise becomes automatic. Hallelujah! So all over the world, to the Raising the Broadcast coming to you live with your host, Dr. N.D. Audu, the anointed man of God from Taraba State in Nigeria, but residing in the city of Albany here in the state of Georgia in United. But it's time to stay tuned at mymiracletv.org as well as raisingthedead.org just to enjoy the Raising the Dead program that has been coming to you on a regular basis. And those of you that are internet savvy or you have internet, wherever you might be on the surface of the globe, you can watch us 24 hours, 7 days a week, 365 up to 366 days in the live year. Enjoy yourself, but then tell everybody about it. Share the good news so that your friends and your relatives and neighbors, wherever they might be on the surface of the planet, they can enjoy the program too at mymiracletv.org. We love you and we thank God for you. We are going to pray and then I will be bringing this powerful, revolutionary, message of the living, dynamic God, full of love, compassion, but full of miraculous signs, wonders, and deliverances that He has provided for us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hallelujah! Again, I am Dr. N.D. Audu, the man of God from Nigeria, Africa. Let's pray. Father, we thank You and we bless Your name because You have given us every tool, every weapon necessary not only to live this godly life, but to live a victorious lifestyle, the heavenly type of lifestyle, the godly lifestyle, the life that is exemplified in heaven, that we can live it here on earth, and push the forces of Satan and his demonic kingdom backwards, and win our fellow human beings into this loving, caring, but holy kingdom of God. We thank You, Father, for this great accomplishment that our Lord Jesus Christ has been able to do, that nobody could have done for us, but He did. We say thank You, thank You, thank You. In Jesus' name, we praise and we worship You and exalt Your name. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. And if you've been following this program now for years, and particularly these past months, I've been dealing with you about this, the saving grace of God revealed to us through the person of Jesus Christ, who is the living Word of God, and He's the living grace. But also, we have seen the same Word revealed to us in a written fashion, in the Scriptures, in the Bible. It became logos to us. Praise God. And then as we verbalize and speak the Word of God out, also the same Word in Greek now, we see it becomes rhema and touches people. So we thank God for the saving grace of God, and we are realizing more and more, as I said, I'm bringing some clarity and revelatory, or I can even say revelationary, teaching to correct some things about deviations, dilution, the twisting of the scriptures here and there that has been really doing a lot of ravages in the body of Christ right now, in what I simply say El Cheapo type of grace, cheap type of grace. And all of that is simply because some preachers go to the scriptures and they're tweaking or twisting the word of God here and there. Not only that, they themselves who claim to be experts in what they are talking about, that they are wrong or they are not rightly dividing the word of truth, but also they are projecting this truth, this twisted truth, into the lives of countless people right in their church settings, behind their pulpits, on radio and television, and through the internet, around the whole world. And there's been confusion going on right now in the body of Christ. And like gangrene, or like cancer, or like AIDS, or any epidemic or pandemic that you can know of, this is spreading over the world, all over the body of Christ worldwide, and people are confused about this, the saving grace of God that comes through faith. So I will do my best, by the grace of God, to present to you a very balanced way of understanding the saving grace of God that comes also by faith. And we see it in the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2, explaining that, from particularly verses 7, 8, and 9. Verse 8 particularly, again, that's where the whole thing, for by grace are we saved, those of us who are saved, through faith, and not of our own doings or of our own works, but it is the gift of God. Now, when we understand that grace is God, grace is also His action, His manifestation, something we don't deserve, we don't merit, even to exist, but God decided out of His sovereignty and His grace, He created human beings without anybody advising Him to do that. He did it out of His personality, His love, His grace, His sovereign. He does whatsoever He wants to do. Only He and His Son, or He and His Word and the Holy Spirit, they decide what to do. The archangels don't even step in to give Him any advice. Nobody can advise God except God Himself. So He did everything from His own nature, His DNA, His personality, His attributes. He's that way. So He created mankind, and when mankind fell into sin through Adam and Eve, as we know, God stepped out again to make a way of redeeming, reclaiming, restoring mankind into the rightful position that God initially thought when He created Adam and Eve. All of that was out of His benevolent action. Again, He took His decision to do whatever He wanted to do to save mankind. But we see that work of grace, or the work of salvation, was not only done when Jesus came bodily to hang on the cross in Jerusalem. The Apostle Paul, like other apostles too, had a revelation to understand that Jesus was the Lamb of God that was slain even before the foundation of the earth. He only came in our calendar roughly about 2,000 years ago to fulfill what was already done in the invisible realm in eternity already, before even this world was formed. Amen. Now, it's something we cannot use our intellect to understand. You can't use science or scientific allegory or scientific formula here, or mathematical allegory trying to comprehend this. It's something that is transcendental. It's beyond our brain. Our brains are so small, we can't even comprehend it. But it takes faith for us to receive it. Hallelujah. So,
don't worry about it. I've even used it for my nose. It looks hygienically not proper. No. We talk to you about the virus and the microscopic and the skin. That's the difference. God to you. Hallelujah. Yes. Put your hand over here. Now, you will see how God will be using your hands to get the job done. It's our standard. I know you have the camera, so you're doing much of the camera work. Put your your hand a while. You too. I'm doing it, but I'm coaching you. So hands-on training right here, you're in the Bible school, the medical school too, in God's medical school, the biblical school. Amen?
Amen.
And we're seeing the glory of God in something. Creating miracles taking place right now. Just thank God. Don't ask him for anything. You have already asked him many times over all these years. Now thank him, because he has answered our prayer. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Open your eyes. Excuse me. What is happening?
Thank you, Jesus.
Oh, my Lord. Jesus, thank you.
Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, open your eyes. That one is getting clearer.
Thanks.
Am I right? Getting clearer. We're going with one first, then you'll see the other one popping up. My sister, go behind, close this one up. That's the bad one. Close it, close it. Now remember this. Everybody see this.
Mm-hmm.
Please, again, this is where everybody in the mass hear God.
Yeah.
You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And this is where everybody here, I don't care if the whole city, for the whole nation, we're standing up here to watch the atmosphere. Mm-hmm. Did I touch her?
Yes. No.
No?
You didn't touch
her. You were the ones.
Just.
Who touched her? Am I right?
Yes.
You see, through your hands, because Jesus lives inside you, his hands reach out and clear that eye. You're seeing me? Do what I do. Clap your hands to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Now turn to the other side. This is not a big deal for God. In the name of Jesus, I command that eye to open right now. And that blind spirit, go. Thank you, Lord. Open your eyes. Vision will be coming up.
Oh.
Anything? You see anything?
No.
Not yet. Nothing yet? Nothing yet? Nothing yet? Any sign of light coming in yet?
See a light. Right.
See a light.
Stop right a little bit.
Stop. Yeah.
Still put your hand there. Everybody clap your hands. You see what? You see what? Huh? What do you see?
Yeah,
the windows are open over here. A little bit of light coming up. Am I right? A little bit of some kind of light from that area. Am I right?
So I will be connecting now this grace with faith. And my emphasis will be more and more now on the faith, because I've dealt with this grace issue, and we've seen the definition of it, of course, from language to language, either from the original language of the Bible, which is Aramaic or Hebrew, and then later on with the spread of Greek language in the ancient civilizations The Greek civilization or the Greek language became so popular that even when Rome controlled the whole world in the sphere of academia, of education, Greek was the major language of communication for the intellectuals and those who were scholarly prepared or who are some kind, you know, they were educated, if you like. Amen. So we are going to see that when we are translating or interpreting or transliterating, we lose certain steam in certain languages from one language to another. For example, let me use this. I will compare the English language with the French language that I speak, read and write fluently, if I'm even better than my mother language. You know, my mother language, Jukun, I read it, I write it, I speak it, but sincerely speaking, since for 30 something years now that I don't even live in Africa anymore, thank God I've still kept and I've still communicate with my relatives over there. I speak with them in Jukun and Hausa, I do that too, but I feel more comfortable speaking English and French because, you see, I have been so much bombarded in my communication now since I live here in America, and also I call my family in France and I talk with them, my wife, children, all of them, I talk with them, and then I have some of my members, the members of our ministry in France, so I communicate with them in French language a lot. Look at it here. The French language for love, which is aimer, the verb aimer, and they use aimer means love. And when you say I love, they will say j'aime. I love. But when we bring it into English, now English almost seems to be a little bit stronger or richer, even though both of them are Latin languages. You can see in English you say I like, and during my early school years, as they were teaching us grammar, English grammar, they were showing us that like, to say I like, in most cases you apply that like, which means to appreciate or to esteem or to show some kind of affinity towards something, you use like towards things and animals. But then when you use the word love, it's towards a being, a living being. For example, you love yourself, you love your mama, your daddy, your brothers and sisters, and you love God. Good, and we understand. But the French people use j'aime, I like, you know. So if they, you know, want to go between the like and the love here now, the French people will say j'adore. J'adore. And adorer, or to adore, as we know, is adoration. And you don't use the word adoration upon any creature, whether angels or human beings or things. You only use it towards God, the supreme almighty God himself. He's the one you use that. So here, when you come to that word love, you can see the English language seems to be a little bit richer than French. Okay? So when you go from Greek, Aramaic into our English language, you can see even with the translation of the King James, of the Bible and other new translations we're having, we see that sometimes we lose steam. We lose certain expression because certain languages are stronger than others. Some are richer than others. Some have more vocabularies than others. And so, in the modern time we're living in, most of the Bible preachers who are coming out, for example, when they focus upon Ephesians 2 and 8, and we don't understand the background of the Jewish culture or the Greek culture, the riches of those languages, we confuse ourselves, and we just, not only that we confuse ourselves and we twist scriptures here and they take them out of context and we beat ourselves down and hurt ourselves, but those who are listening to us too are affected by the contagion of our mistakes. And this is why we need real balance in the Word of God. Again, this is Dr. M.D. Audu, the mind of God, you know, speaking to you now as we're talking about. You're listening to us at the Raising the Dead broadcast and are coming to you at mymiracletv.org. Stay tuned because we are going to see the balance message of God's salvation to mankind. It is favor he's doing to us, but he's doing it also in conjunction with faith. So grace and faith work hand in hand. And the theological interpretation we've been putting on faith, as many take that Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, we are thinking that, okay, when you receive it by faith, that means what? It's a lazy man's game. It's a passive word. We think that faith has nothing to do with it. You only sit on your blessed assurance, blessed daydreaming, blessed hope, wishy-washy hope, And then now God will throw that salvation on you because everything is cooked up by Jesus Christ, already accomplished. You and I, we do nothing. And God cooked up the salvation, He cooked up the grace, and He cooked up faith, and dumps everything to our own heads, our hearts, our minds, and we do nothing. That is the wrong way of doing it. Why? We have precedents. We have some examples throughout the scriptures. From the Old Testament all the way to the New Testament, you will see when God gave somebody His favor, that person is a recipient. That means he has to receive. God does the giving, and we do the receiving. So on His own part, He extends. He initiates and extends the whole thing to us. We also initiate. He gives us the will and the strength, the ability also to initiate reaching out our hands of faith to receive. It takes action. Faith is an action word. It's not a passive word. Faith is a person. It's a living, dynamic person of Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith. He's the Alpha and the Omega of our faith. He's the A to Z of our faith. And we are seeing sincerely, a lot of Christians don't even know what true faith is. They don't even know how faith works. They don't know how faith comes. And they are hearing this wishy-washy teaching about faith. You do nothing. You just sit down. And I tell you, I see sometimes some of the laziest people I've ever seen in my life are church folks. I'm not saying everybody, but a lot is due to the wrong teachings we are receiving. So people of God are passively doing nothing, expecting Jesus to come down from heaven and rapture us out of this world. Then when we go to heaven now, we're going to get our crowns and get our get reward for what? If you do nothing, you get nothing. We are saved unto good works. Even though the work has already been accomplished by Jesus, there is the human factor, the human responsibility. There's our own part to play. Why? Because it's a covenant relationship. In the covenant between two or multiple parties, there's an agreement that I do this, you do that, he or she will do that. Everybody does something. Not just one person doing it. It will be imbalanced. So, let's see something here as I'll be reading today. And I'll be dealing with the subject of faith in collaboration with grace. Because they work hand in hand. And the emphasis of faith here, as we see in the book of James, chapter 2. The Apostle James was writing, and he brought balance to what Ephesians also said. Paul wrote his own part dissertation about really a description of the grace of God through faith. And James also wrote about the grace of God through faith, walking faith. And for Paul, it seems as though it is silent when it comes to the human responsibility. But Paul understood that from precedents or from previous experiences, including he himself as Saul of Tarsus converted to Christ, Paul went through some things because he put his faith into action. He wasn't saying that I just sat down on my blessed assurance as a Jewish, young person, as a Pharisee, a Benjamite, and a scholar, from the University of Jerusalem under Gamaliel, and I was just, sitting like this, and then Jesus manifested himself to me. No. On the way to Damascus, we saw what happened. If you read the book of Acts chapter 9, Paul had an encounter with Jesus. Because initially, Paul hated Jesus, and he hated every believer that believed in Jesus. Paul was out to exterminate them. In his rage and persecution and desire to exterminate and destroy, to decimate Christianity, Paul had an encounter with Jesus. And that grace of God was revealed to him. And you will see from that Acts, chapter 9, all the way to the end, you will see the life of Paul full of action. He was a man of faith. He didn't take the grace of God lightly. He took the grace of God with action. And all in all, from that baptism that Ananias came and baptized him, lay hands on Paul, and the blind eyes of Paul were opened, and Paul received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Paul arose. He arose. He stood up now, gallantly took the gospel in the midst of hard persecution from the religious system of his time that he used to be part of. Paul became a very active faith man. He had faith in God, faith in Christ, and he proved it. He demonstrated that faith without action is dead, as James says in chapter 2. If you say you have faith and your faith has no action backing it up, you're wasting your time. It's not going to work. Just as a human body without a spirit is dead, the same thing, faith without corresponding action, that faith is dead. Hallelujah. But
in the book of Psalms, it says the secret things of God are only revealed to those who fear God. So that means that God is a God of secrecy, or he has some things he has hidden for mankind, and he doesn't reveal them to everybody except to anybody or any group of people that will fear him, reverence him, love him, obey him, and believe him. I'm Dr. N.D. Audu, the man of God from Nigeria, Africa, but living here in the state of Georgia. And I welcome you to our Raising the Dead broadcasting, and particularly to our website, which is mymiracletv.org, as well as raisingthedead.org. And I'm holding in my hand, you can see how happy and glad that I am to present to the whole wide world one out of my book series. This is an international based selling series known as the Raising the Dead series. And I have here, out of the 17, 18 books, I have another book here titled 10 Best Kept Secrets on How to Raise the Dead. 10 Best Kept Secrets. God kept them secretly, and he revealed them to me and to other people too that are really seriously seeking for him. And I want you to get to know these secrets for yourself. Because if everybody could do it, they would have been doing it. Mankind is dying. People are dying all around us in our towns and villages and cities and nations, advanced nations as well as less advanced nations. People are dying daily everywhere around the world. And they are asking for questions. Who knows how to do this? Who knows how to solve this problem? Who knows how to raise the dead? It seems we are not getting the message that God is giving to us. But I am really hungry for God, and I want God to reveal it to me. So I went through the scriptures, the Bible, and I discovered the 10 best secrets that God has taught me, and I'm teaching people all over the world how they can say no to death and say, no, you can't take me before my time, and you cannot take my loved one before their God-giving time. So go get the 10 best secrets, the 10 best secrets on how to raise the dead. Hallelujah. The 10 best secrets. You need to get this book, but not only this one, but the entire Raising the Dead collection. It will change your life, it will prolong your life and help you too to change other people's lives and prolong their lives until they fulfill their destinies here on earth. Hallelujah. To God be all the glory. Again, go to mymiracletv.org as well as raisingthedead.org to get the entire collection of the Raising the Dead series, particularly the 10 best kept secrets that God has revealed to your friend Dr. Andy Audu. Hallelujah.
But here in chapter 18 of the Gospel of Luke, Jesus was teaching, and he said something here, very interestingly. You will see from verse 1 all the way to verse 8. He was going to teach us about the tenacity of faith. If you have faith, your faith will be tested. Your faith has to be proved. So in this chapter 18 of the Gospel of Luke, he said in a city there was a judge who was really a pagan. He was, you know, an atheist. He was a godless man. He didn't believe in God, and he had no regards, no respect, no appreciation for his fellow human beings. But in the same city too, there was a widow who was wrongly, misused by a neighbor. She kept on coming to that judge for justice, and the judge didn't want to do her justice. But you see, the determination of that woman, that never quitting spirit, she refused to, throw in the towel. She kept on bombarding the judge, coming, knocking and screaming and yelling. And some women are very, women are dangerous. Some men too, but women, they don't care. Some men, you know, because of self-respect, we don't want to embarrass anybody. We will maybe go and hide our faces a little bit. But women, when they're determined to get something, they'll get it. So this old lady, this widow, persevered, kept on coming, and she wore the judge out completely. But her tenacity, persistence. And finally, the judge said, look, even though I don't fear God, I don't even believe that there is God, and I have no regard for my fellow human being, because of this woman's dangerous attack over my house, coming to give me sleepless night, day and night, she's coming and wearing me out, disturbing me, I've got to do her justice. And now in verse 8, that is where Jesus put the nail down on the coffin. He said, when the Son of Man comes, will he still find faith on the earth? Will he still find faith in our world? I tell you, every time I read that, it sends some chill bumps all over me, until with my years now of the experience of salvation that I had, 36, over 36 years now, to this day, and after I moved to United States, and I'm discovering some of the teachings about faith, I said, dear Lord, you are perfectly right. Erosion of faith, destruction of faith, and it doesn't come from pagans, it doesn't come from New Ages, it doesn't come from, you know, ACLU, or it doesn't come from the atheistic groups, or from the government, or from any source. The biggest attacks of the erosion of faith comes from the pulpits, churches, preachers. We have really confused God's people about this faith teaching, just as we're doing with grace, and now there's a salad, there's a cocktail of confusion in the body of Christ. People give you impression that they believe or they have faith. In reality, when it comes to the evidence or the proofs or the action to manifest it, you will realize they have got no faith at all. They are working on presumption. They give you a facade. They make you think, as they're shaking their head, I believe. But in the reality, they don't believe, or they believe it wrongly. So Jesus said, when he will return, particularly, either for the rapture or by the time he's going to establish his kingdom here on earth, there will be almost, even if it's not the grace of God, it will be hard even to find the true picture, the true example of faith, biblical faith, the God kind of faith on this planet. So, let's give some correction. We need some balance here now. What is faith? Or, in other words, to say it correctly, who is faith? Because God is faith. The Holy Ghost is the spirit of faith. Hallelujah. Faith is not a sensation. It's not a feeling. Even though we might feel it. It's not even what we see. Faith is God himself. Just like grace. Like salvation. Like love. Miracle. Everything you can talk about that we use as though they're only words and feelings and sensations. In reality, they are the personalities of God himself. You and I cannot be saved simply because we say so. We are saved because the Savior comes to dwell inside. Or salvation himself. Jesus said, you know, for example, the case of, you know, Zacchaeus. When Zacchaeus welcomed Jesus into his house, he said, today, the salvation of God has come into this man's house. It wasn't because Zacchaeus had a mental accident about it. No, he received the person of salvation into his house and into his life. Hallelujah. So Jesus said, when he returns, will he still find faith on earth? The pandemic effect of some of the wrong teachings bombarding our churches, our pulpits, radio, TV programs, books and CDs and DVDs that are spreading everywhere. Sometimes I wonder, my God, what is faith in this? Yet some of us are claiming we're teachers of faith. I've heard preachers on syndicated national and international radio broadcasts and television broadcasts come in on the internet too. I mean, they talk faith. In reality, when I listen to them, I say, my God, what are they talking about? are sort of affirming, making themselves to look as expert, but they don't even have a clue about what they're talking about. So Jesus let us know here about that faith is of God. Faith comes from God because God himself is faith. Amen. Now it says here, I know in the book of Hebrews, we see the real common definition we've been given: faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. Am I right? We're going on. With the Hebrews, we will see clearly here. Faith, you know, we define faith, particularly in Hebrews 11. He says what? Faith is the substance of things we hope for and the evidence of things not seen. It's one of the definitions we use of what, how, you know, faith comes, or what faith is and how it comes. The Apostle Paul, writing throughout his epistle, you can see, he not only gave the definition of faith, but also he shows us how faith comes. But simply said, if you read Hebrews 11 now, you can understand from the beginning of that chapter 11 all the way to the end of it, you will see that to summarize the definition of faith, it means simply taking God at his word. Believing God, no matter what. It means submission to God. He tells you something, you take it. Unwaveringly, without doubting or questioning it, you take it to the bank or you put action into it. And so Paul used examples of heroes of faith here and there in the book of Hebrews. You could see how the manifestation of faith came. What happened with Noah? With Abel, Noah, all the way to Enoch, and they came to to Abraham, and then to Moses, and came to David and Samuel. I mean, on and on and on and so forth. I mean, you'll be seeing the exemplifications of faith in manifestation here and there. And Jesus is asking, when he returns, will he still find faith on earth? It's left to you and I now to answer. He's not saying that it's not possible, and he's not saying that it's impossible. It depends upon individuals, how you live your life.
Did you know that the devils are afraid of you as an anointed child of God? To buy your copy of Believers That Make the Devils Nervous, visit MyMiracleTV.org or call 1-229-638-1065. In this revolutionary book, Dr. Indy Audu teaches you about the origin of the demonic world, how demons operate negatively in our world today, their deceptive tricks and tactics, their strengths and weaknesses, and much more. But above all, how you can always defeat and destroy their activities around you.
So when God gives us his favor, his grace, his mercy, or his charisma, we receive by faith. Why? Because we walk by faith and not by sight. And then anybody that has been justified, or the Bible says, the just shall live by faith. And let me give you a very quick personal story here. You will see how faith works. But before that, let me quickly give you this. We see three major appearances or the actions of faith, or types of faith. We see the saving grace faith in Ephesians 2:8, the saving faith that works with grace. Then also we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, particular verse 9, as one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you see the gift of faith. Then you go to Galatians chapter 5. You will see verses 19, 20, 21, all the way 22. You will see here, he talks about also the fruit of faith or faithfulness. These three areas, we see how faith really come show of himself in the life of a believer: the saving faith, the gift of faith, and the fruit of faith. It's still the same faith, one baptism, one Lord. However, the manifestations are variable. They come in different forms and styles. As the Holy Spirit moves upon believers to get things done. Now, when we are saved, we put faith towards the work of redemption and salvation from sin and all the consequences of sin. That is a saving faith. You put action into it, because if you don't put action, that faith will not work. Then also, as true believers now, because we are converted and we are connected to Jesus Christ, that faith again keeps on flowing in us now to live that Christian lifestyle. Not only that we claim that we were saved last week or last month or 10 or 30 or 40 years ago, it's a continuous experience you go through while you're still alive here on earth. It takes faith to walk it through. That's why people say, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are walking. W-A-L-K-I-N-G, walking. It shows movement. Since the day you receive Jesus Christ unto the day that he calls you out of this world, it's a journey, it's an adventure. And it takes faith to see you through. And during that adventure, we have a lot of challenges, a lot of temptations, a lot of decisions to make. And every day of our lives, we need to put our faith to help us through. So we need really the gift of faith. Especially, again, I can say in terms of ministry. You see, I've been confronted with a lot. If the testimonies of what God has led me through for 36 years worldwide, as I've been crisscrossing this planet, I see not only that saving faith of God in my heart, in my life daily, that shows me that I am in good standing with God. I'm saved. I'm not lost. I'm no more a child of the devil. I'm a child of God. I belong to Jesus. So that saving faith keeps me aware of it every day. But then when as a minister of the gospel, I also see 1 Corinthians 12 in action now in my life to get some daunting challenges solved in terms of signs, wonders, and miracles. I need a good dose of faith to operate. Some years ago, you know, they brought this young man, and he was born handicapped. He had no ears at all on his head, no hole on the side of his head. That means he couldn't hear, he couldn't speak. I have never seen this kind of miracle before in my ministry, never. A human being deformed. It's just like somebody having a face but no eyes. Yet the person, seeing. That's something about nature. You know, it defies the law of science, biological science or the law of medicine. I need a miracle. So they brought this young man, he was handicapped, no ears at all, on his side of the head. No hole, no sign physically to show me that he had, ear organs, outside. When his baby sister brought him, he was about 23, 24 years old. Now I knew, I said, God, I have never seen this miracle, but with you I know that all things are possible. Lord, you can do the impossible. I just simply prayed for that young man, and I'll be telling you, the crowd was watching this in front of me. There wasn't any physical creative ears put on the young man's body. But when I turned the microphone to this young man for 23 years or 24 years of his life, that he never heard and never spoke one word. The moment the microphone, after I prayed and I gave the microphone to him, the young man was repeating what I was saying. Not only that, he spoke the best English grammar I've ever heard in my life. Without ears, how could he manage to hear? Without ear organs. But God specializes in doing the impossible. But he depended upon me to put my faith into action. The gift of faith. So not only have the saving faith, but also I have, as a minister of the gospel, some of the challenges to bring this gospel of great signs, wonders, and miracles. I've got the gift of faith to operate in my life. When I stand before dead bodies or dying persons, somebody who is already in the casket and they are ready to bury the person, it defies the law of science, the law of logic. It transcends us. Guess what? The Holy Spirit will drop that faith, that gift of faith into my spirit. Then it is connected to the workings of miracles. And the moment I release the prayer of faith, I see the dead person rising up. Why? Because I need that faith. And Jesus said, when he comes back to the world, where will he still find faith? Talk about missing bodies in people's body, or stopping hurricanes and storm or drought, to pray that God will bring rain, or where there's too much of rain, we pray that the rain will stop. I mean, this is a display of the gift of faith, according to 1 Corinthians 12. And even the provision of food. As I told this story, how that small quantity of rice that I had, you know, and I had about almost 18, less than 20 people, about 18 of us, small quantity of rice, a little child could have eaten that rice and still be, you know, be hungry. But we cooked the rice. I told my young brother, you know, I mean, he's older than me, but I called him in faith. I was discipling him. I said, let's pray. That was before I was even married. We prayed over that little small quantity of rice. We prayed. As all of us, 18 of us, started eating the rice, God kept on multiplying the rice. The rice refused to finish. Right in front of us. It takes the gift of faith. Hallelujah!
For over 30 years in nearly 40 nations around the world, God has been using Dr. Andy Audu mightily, according to John 14:12, to raise many physically dead and dying people, heal the sick, operate many special miracles, as well as winning many sinners to Christ. As the author of the internationally best-selling series known as Raising the Dead, Dr. Audu has been honorably received by many world leaders. Now, ladies and gentlemen, log on to raisingthedead.org for additional details, because Dr. Audu is coming to your area for a great meeting, and you need to be there.
So, you see, we need not only the seven faith, we need the gift of faith. When challenges come in your home, in your ministry, in your nation, in your job, in your church, or in your community where you live, we need not only the saving faith, we need the gift of faith in action to see us through. Help us either to override, navigate, circumvent, or whatever, or move the mountains up. And by so doing now, it leads us from the saving faith to the gift of faith. Now it moves us to what we call the faithfulness of faith, if you like. It becomes now the fruit of the Holy Spirit in our lives. God can depend upon us. He can count on us because we are reliable. We're dependent. And then now we too, we trust God. We know that God is a faithful God and we are His faithful sons and daughters. We cannot put His name in disgrace. As you know, you remember the story of Job. When God was talking to Satan, when Satan came to that conference hall in heaven, while the angels were appearing there, and God was bragging so much on Job. He said, Job is a faithful man. He's a very humble man. He's a holy man. He's a righteous man. And God knew that, look, Job was somebody he could depend upon, and Job would not disappoint him. And Satan was trying to prove God to be a liar. Guess what? You know what? Satan received a slap in his mouth, so to speak. He failed the exam, but God won. After Job was tested here and there, that man stood still. He said, naked I came into this world, naked I'll go. Blessed be the name of the Lord. This man refused to quit on God, even though his wife backed up. I mean, he stood his position. Why? From saving faith to give up faith, and now to the fruit of faith, which is faithfulness. Hallelujah. God is looking for people like this in his body right now. People that can take God and manifest the glory of God. To show to the whole world we're different. We're saved by grace through faith. Also, in the midst of challenges, persecutions, and sufferings, we have the gift of faith acting through us, that we can overcome the trials of life that Satan will try to throw at us, or God will allow us to go through. And in this last part of it, God wants to see the fruit of faith in us, fruitfulness, or the faithfulness of God manifested in our life. That we live not a yo-yo lifestyle. One time we believe God, we trust God. Another time we're doubting God here. We believe in one time in the church, then during the week, you know, we doubt Him. No. He wants us to be faithful, stabilized. That nothing shakes us and moves us. Nothing makes us even to doubt God. We believe God no matter what. And I wish, you know, I had more time really to tell you sincerely that this message of a balanced faith, it's needed in the body of Christ today, like never before. And I thank God for God allowing us to have these scriptures here. That poor widow woman refused to quit. And the judge had to, you know, cave in. I mean, finally had to give the woman justice. And so Jesus, that's why he said, you know, that men, human beings, we've got to pray and never faint. We don't need to pray a little bit and quit. You keep on, why? Because the tenacity of faith will keep you pushing. The Holy Spirit doesn't give up. And God is looking for people like this that will rock the devil's world like never seen before, simply because they know how to operate in faith. They are yielded to God. They are sold out to God. The God of faith is in control over their lives as he brought salvation in, and he's working out salvation daily and daily and daily until the day that they are raptured, or they go to, you know, back to God through sleeping in faith, if you like. They sleep in faith. They don't die. They sleep in faith. Why? Because they were faithful to God. And I pray that God will help us now to see. If you're listening to me, my brother and my sister, this is about time. Get to the Bible. Don't just allow the preachers telling you their own opinions about faith, about grace. Allow the Word of God to be imbibed in your spirit so that you'll be established, stabilized, and not confused. And not yielding to the devil's temptation, living in sin just in the name of grace, simply because, you know, sometimes preachers will tell you, if you just leave, God knows that everybody's weak, nobody's perfect, and God, you know, he can tolerate this and that. Only, or you just come and get the financial, material blessings, and God will bless you. He will give you money. He will give you nice houses. Excuse me. The grace of God is not an excuse for us to live in sin. Hate sin, run away from sin, and embrace God. You will see God knocking your socks out with tremendous blessings, and wherever you go, you will be the one putting the devils out of business, because your flesh is crucified and God is operating through you by faith. Hallelujah. Again, this is Dr. N.D. Audu, the man of God that loves the Word of God and loves God, but also is encouraging you, read and study John chapter 14 verse 12, my favorite verse of the Bible. Bye bye. We'll see you next time by the grace of God.
You have just listened to a dynamic dead raising program by Dr. N.D. Audu. If you're in the Albany, Georgia area, you're warmly invited to attend this weekly Miracle Pack meeting every Sunday at 2 p.m. at 1012 North Van Buren Street in Albany, Georgia. Seating is limited. For more information about this global ministry, books, publications, please contact Nations for Christ International Ministry at Post Office Box 1513 in Albany, Georgia 31702, or at the office. That's 229-638-1065. You can also visit the life-changing website at www.raisingthedead.org or mymiracletv.org for helpful resources.